Another month of Godot development brings us exciting new features. Godot 4.4 has now officially entered its beta phase, and here's a look at some of the latest updates and improvements. The new game window lets you play your game directly inside Godot. Activate the 3D selection mode to click on in-game objects and select them in the Remote tab. And you can change their properties in real time while the game is running. When you are ready to play again, press the input button and re-enable player controls. Another option is to use this mode in a floating window. This will keep your debug controls and start the game in another window. It lets you pause the game and advance frame by frame to inspect any issues your game might have. Select the camera icon to freely move your game cameras around, just like in the editor. Holding the right mouse button to move the camera and move around with the WSD keys. You can play the game with the new camera position, or press the camera button again to return to the normal camera. If you don't like this mode, you can also disable it and run your game just like before. Gridmaps have received some major enhancements to improve their usability. Tiles now appear in the bottom panel with new updated controls. While placing tiles, now a ghost preview of the tile will show up under the cursor. You can rotate tiles quickly with hotkeys or the buttons below for fast placements, and use the selection mode to select a group of tiles. Move them around by cutting the selection, duplicate them, and even rotate the whole selection, making it much easier to create maps using gridmaps. The transform mode allows you to navigate the grid map easily while editing. Enabling it will unlock navigation controls so you can move around. Then turn it off and go back to create your map. And that's not all. You can now customize your grid color for better visibility. And changes to the grid map preview size now update immediately. The global illumination baking has seen some significant advancements. The Lightmap GI node now supports transparency, which is a great improvement for maps that use them. There is also now support for shadow masks. To use them, make sure to select shadow mask mode and rebake your Lightmap GI node. You can set your shadow mask modes to replace or to overlay existing shadows. And there is even now support for baked colored shadows. The AgX tone map has been added, giving you more control over your game's visual appearance. Some adjustments are still pending, so expect some minor changes before the final release. The profiler window has also received some love. You now have the option to auto-start the profiler and visual profiler when starting the game, making it much easier to debug initialization issues. You'll see a yellow warning icon on the top to show that auto-start is enabled. The visual profiler will now show your CPU and GPU models at the top. And you can now zoom in and pan around inside the profiler window to see those lines up close. There is now a spring bone for all your 3D model animation needs. You can add them to your skeleton and make your character jiggle all around, especially useful for hair meshes. The project manager also had some changes. It now starts with a larger size for better usability, and you can now import new projects without immediately opening them. Just uncheck the edit now and your project will be imported without opening them. And for broken projects, you can now open projects in recovery mode. This will disable some features and automated recovery systems to allow you to at least open the project to diagnose your problems and salvage some parts of the project. After you're done, you can use the yellow button at the top to restart the project in normal mode. The gdscript editor has got some incredible new addition. You can now hover over any code element in your script to display its documentation. It works for functions, properties, classes, and even local variables. There are still some big features remaining, but first, here are some of the small but very useful ones. Particle spawn areas now have gizmos. You can now visualize the particle spawn area and don't have to guess anymore. The ability to change the gizmo size with the mouse is not here yet, and will be added later due to some problems. But for now, we can see the gizmos changing by altering their values in the inspector, which is already a great help. Particle sub-emitters now have the ability to spawn at the start. For 3D, we now have a way to measure distances. You can now take quick measurements of your game's world. You can see the camera's preview inside the inspector when they're selected now, making it much easier to adjust your cameras. If the selection gizmo is in the way, you are now able to hide the transforms arrow. You can now right-click any asset inside the quick open window and use the Show in File System option to quickly go to that file. This also works for sprites inside the Animated Sprites node. Plugins have some additions too. You now have a way to add more options to several context menus throughout Godot, be it inside the code, on screen tabs, or even in the scene itself. And there is now a proper way to move your scene's camera using a plugin now. Another great addition is the new search filter option. How many times have you wanted to quickly search for some node, only to have to spend time opening the hierarchies and look for the correct one? Now you can enable the Hide Filter Out Parent option to display only the filtered nodes, making it much easier to find and select what you want. The Polygon UV Editor has changed locations and name. It is now called Polygon and it is at the bottom of the screen now. Web builds now support MIDI audio. You can now create a twin that ignores a game timescale, which is helpful to keep your UI twin animations fluid inside of slow motions. And twins can now have subtwins for a more precise and complex twinning actions. Finally, a few more big changes. The new UAD system should now be more stable. Now Godot non-resource files like scripts and shaders should generate a .uid file to keep track of things, and make sure your project stays safe when moving things around. Multimeshes now has an option to use indirect draw, improving its performance, especially for dense scenes like grass fields. The second out of three improvements made with the Forge and Google collaboration has been merged. These are a series of low-level optimizations that should improve the overall performance of Godot as a whole. There is a lot of technical details here if you want to dig around. With Godot 4.4 now in beta phase, it is now feature-free, meaning the coming weeks will focus on fixing bugs and stability issues. So any new features not completed now will be postponed for later. Here are some of the interesting ones that will most likely have to wait a bit more. That includes the addition of abstract classes for gdscript, calling editor scripts by name using the command palette, exposing only a few selected children of the scene for a cleaner view, gizmos controls for the new particle emission gizmos, and the one I was really hoping for, that add the ability to have indirect collision shapes, not needing them to be direct children of the physics body node. On some other news, you can check out the Outskirts demo, which showcases just how good you can make Godot look like. I am not running on max settings here, but you can already see how the light and environment in this demo feels like. You can get this demo in the itch.io page link in the description. But that's it. There is a lot of new features in 4.4 that I didn't cover here. The ones here are mainly features that have been merged in the last month out of the total 5 that 4.4 has been in production. There is a lot more in this version for you to find out. I hope you liked this video, and until next time.